just muted.
Thank you, Jesus.
How's everybody doing today?
Good.
Good, good. We serve a mighty God, a glorious God. I have so much to share today. I don't know how the Lord is going to lead me. So I'm going to start in the verse of scripture where we were last week in Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4. There's so much going on. When I got up today to do the message, I was thinking about how when I first started trying to teach 20 years ago now almost, I used to experience feeling sick. And I understood at that time that I was being fought spiritually and I would press through it. But I had no understanding at that time of how much evil worked and how it comes against people. I know there's a lot I still don't understand, but I understand it a lot more today than I did 20 years ago. And if you give in to that feeling, if you give in to those things that the enemy does to you, you'll live a defeated life. And there's so many people who are being afflicted and tormented by evil with sickness and discouragement and depression. And they don't understand that it's a force of darkness that's coming against them. And also, most people back in the time when I got saved, I understood that I wanted to be different. I became consciously aware of sin, but I didn't understand how to resist the sin. And I find today a lot of people are genuine about their walk, their relationship with God, but they don't know the evil that's coming against them to set traps and snares for them. So they say they get saved, or they say they believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, but there's no change in their lives, and there's no one that they know of to help support them or encourage them or correct them. And so I try to every week give you all as many scriptures as I can. But if you don't take the scriptures, if you don't study the Word of God, if you don't put the Word in you, you will continue to live a defeated life because you are in a battle. And the battle is for your souls, because the enemy don't want you to live a holy and an upright, sanctified life, because you would represent and bring glory to God. And the people who are genuine about their walk with God, that is trying to live that way, are under a greater attack, because the enemy has to destroy you and steal from you your faith. He's trying to get you to stop. He's trying to get you to quit and stop having faith and belief in Jesus Christ. Am I making sense to you so far? So in the fourth chapter of Hebrews, verse 2 says, "Unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them." Them talking about the people back in the Old Testament time. "But the word preached did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it." In them that heard it, the gospel didn't profit them because they didn't mix it with faith. Turn to James chapter 1. James chapter 1. Thank you, Lord. James is the one, that's the next book over. Chapter 1, verse 21 says, "Lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your souls." It's all about saving your souls. "Be you doers of the word, and not hearers only," underline, "deceiving your own selves." If you hear the word and you don't put it into practice, you deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word, and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. You look in the mirror, you see your face. For he behold himself and goes his way, and straightway, right away, forget what manner of man he was. But whoso looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues therein, he is being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work. This man shall be blessed in his deed. This man who does and not just hear shall be blessed in his deeds. Oh, thank you. Oh, goodness. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Elder Chuck. Elder Chuck is concerned about my looks. So anyway, I want you to turn now to Matthew, the chapter Matthew. We're going to read this chapter. And I pray in the name of Jesus Christ that you get something out of it. I was really blessed last week when we had visitors who were from India. And they were saying that they don't watch the TV anymore because every time they turn on the TV, the ministers, so-called ministers, really who are the ministers of Satan, is talking about nothing that's going to benefit or exalt people's souls or save their souls. And they were saying that they were blessed because of how many scriptures that they were getting. And they actually sent me an email, and I have been in touch with them since, and they continued to say that they were blessed by the scriptures. And the scriptures brings comfort, encouragement, instructions, and correction. And so if you don't get into the scriptures, which is what most people do who go to a church, and they get all emotional and they get into, they hear the word and they feel convicted, but they leave. And some people do this for years, week after week after week. They listen to the scriptures, but when they leave, they just like the scriptures that we just got through reading in James. They look into the scriptures, they hear the scriptures, and they'll walk right out the door and continue to live as though they never heard the scriptures. And those are the people who are going to end up hearing the God say, "Depart from me, I never knew you." And I feel as though we have to continue to hear these verses of scriptures over and over and over again, because no one who's been in the scriptures and looking at the news and looking at the people in your community or the place where you work or go to school cannot be convicted to see that the word of God is true, because we are living through it. We see people changing. We see people don't want to have anything or hear anything about God. Am I making sense? All right, let's start at chapter 13, verse 1 says, "The same day went Jesus out of the house and sat by the seaside." How many of you understand Jesus sat by the seaside because the water acted like a microphone so the people could hear a long ways off? He didn't need a microphone. It says, "And great multitudes were gathered together unto him, so that he went into a ship and sat. And the whole multitude stood on the shore. And he spake many things unto them in parables." He spake many things to them in parables, saying, "Behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprang up, because they had no depthness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, because they had no root, they withered away." They had no root, they withered away. "And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up and choked them. But other fell into good ground and brought forth fruit, some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30. Who has, I want you to underline and circle, who has ears to hear, let him hear. Who has ears to hear, let him hear. This is Jesus speaking. If your Bible was written in red represents Christ speaking. And the disciples came and said unto him, why speak thou unto them in parables? They're asking him a question. He answered and said unto them, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. You know that you try to speak to people about the scriptures and about the times and the things you see taking place and the things you're understanding, and nobody wants to listen. That's the same thing was happening back then. And Jesus is saying, he was speaking to them in a parable, and it says, who has ears to hear, let him hear. Let's continue on. Verse 12. For whosoever has, to him shall be given, and he shall have more abundance. But whosoever has not, from him shall be taken away even that he has. Therefore speak I to them in parables, because they seeing see not. You got people today, they see the trees falling, the leaves dying. They see the evil things that's going on in the movies, the dramas, the technology, the transhumanism, the sodomy, all the things. They see, but they don't see. Do you understand? Let's see this. Jesus is saying, so people can see all of this stuff, but they really don't understand what's going on. Let's read on. And hearing, they hear not. And underline, neither do they understand. Just, y'all have to remember this. God, Jesus is speaking, and he's speaking to his disciples. He's speaking to the people who believe in him. So the other people around them, they stood on the shore, on the shore, and they heard, and they saw Jesus, but they did not hear, and they did not see, and they did not understand. And in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah. Isaiah prophesies this, which says, by hearing you shall hear, and shall not understand. And seeing, you shall see, and shall not perceive. They don't perceive how late the time is. They don't perceive anything because they don't even know Jesus. They don't know the word of God. They go to church. They don't study. And you can talk to people who say they are Christians. You can talk to people who say they know the word, but they don't know Jesus. And they do not perceive. For this people's heart is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of hearing, and their eyes, they have closed. Isn't this something? They closed. People, Renata was telling me she was looking to the, she was listening to the Democratic convention, and they had a pastor on there preaching about it's okay to be gay. So he would fit into the category that his ears are dull of hearing, and his eyes are closed, lest at any time they should at any time see with their eyes and hear with their ears and should understand with their heart. If they understand with their heart and should be converted, I should heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. That's what I'm saying to you today. If you understand, blessed are your eyes and your ears. For verily or truly I say unto you, that many prophets and religious men have desired to see those things which, now he's specifically speaking to his disciples who was with him, see those things which you see and have not seen them, and to hear those things which you hear and have not heard them. Hear you therefore the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom, he's given the answer, and understands it not, then comes the wicked one. This is why people won't understand. The wicked one, and catches away that which was sown in his heart. Make sure that's not you. This is he which receives seed by the wayside. So now he's given the understanding of the parable. But he that received the seed into stony places, the same as he that hears the word and anon with joy receive it, yet has not root in himself. Conviction in himself. but endures for a while. For when tribulation or persecution, remember that word, those words, tribulation and persecution arises because of the word. So because you know the word is being sown in you, persecution and tribulation arises. By and by, as time goes by, he is offended. He gets discouraged. He stops believing. It's too hard. Persecution, tribulation. Nobody is telling you persecution and tribulation is going to come to you because you know the word, because you're studying the word, because you're living by the word. So you get offended. You get discouraged. He also that received seed among the thorns is he that hears the word, and the cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becomes unfruitful. So when you get so caught up and you want about your career, the deceitfulness of riches, the cares of this world, those things this parable is saying chokes out the word. So the word doesn't have any value to you, doesn't find any place in you, because those things chokes the word out of you. Do you see it? But he that receive seed into the good ground is he that hears the word and understands it, which also bears fruit. That's the person who brings the fruit, the hundredfold, the 60-fold, and 30. So you have to consider, which ground are you? Do you give up for tribulation and persecution? Is the enemy able to convince you that there's no faith, that Jesus is not real, that this, none of this matters, that you're just going through the motions and you might as well quit? Because those are the things the enemy will whisper in your heart and your mind. Now, verse 24, another parable put he forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. I love this parable. But while men slept, this is the one to me that is relevant about the Noah and the Lot and the days it's going to be like it was in Lot's days, the wheat and the tares. It says, but while men slept, his enemy came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares. And I told you before that if you research and look up tares, tares is poisonous grass. And you can't tell the difference between the wheat or the tares. The tares are poisonous and it's growing right along with the wheat. So the servants of the householder came and said unto him, sir, not thou sow good seed in thy field? From whence then has it tares? Where did the tares come from? And he said unto them, an enemy has done this. Pay attention. The servant said unto him, will thou then that we go and gather them up? He's asking, should we gather up the tares? But he said, nay, lest while you gather up the tares, you root up also the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest. And in the time of harvest, I will say to the reapers, gather you together first the tares. So God is going to send his angels to gather first the tares. God is going to send forth his angels and bind them in bundles to burn them. So the tares, the poisonous ones who is among the wheat, they're going to be gathered in bundles to burn. But gather the wheat into my barn. Another parable put forth unto them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like to a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all seeds. But when it is grown, it is the greatest among herbs and become a tree, so that the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches thereof. Look at verse 34. All these things spake Jesus unto the multitude in parables, and without a parable spake he not unto them, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet, saying, I will open my mouth in parables. I will utter things which have been kept secret. Things which have been kept secret. Underline that so you can come back to it. From the foundation of the world. Then Jesus sent the multitude away. He sent the whole multitude of people away. And went into the house. And his disciples came unto him, saying, declare unto us the parable of the tares of the field. That's the one they're interested in too. He sent the multitude away. Now they're in private. Him, Jesus, and his disciples. Jesus answered and said unto them, he that sows the good seed is the Son of Man. That's Jesus. The field, he's telling you what it is. The field is the world. So there's no confusion for people to add or misunderstand it, because this is making it clear. The good seed are the children of the kingdom. But the tares are the children of the wicked one. So the children of the wicked one is living right along the children of the kingdom. The enemy, now this is good here, listen. The enemy that sowed them is the devil. Can it get any clearer than that? God is telling you the devil is the one who is sowing the tares. And they live right among you. And you need to be careful. Because only those who got eyes to see and ears to hear and understand is going to know what's going on, especially in these end days. The harvest is the end of the world. And the reapers is not us. The reapers are the angels. Do you see it? As therefore the tares are gathered and burned in the fire. Burned in the fire. The tares are going to be burned in the fire. This is Jesus speaking. So shall it be in the end of this world. So shall it be in the end of this world. The Son of Man shall send forth his angels, and they shall gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, and them which do iniquity or sin or lawlessness. Because that's what we see in the world right now is lawlessness. And shall cast them into a furnace of fire. And there shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then shall the righteous shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of their Father, who has ears to hear. See it again. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. People don't take this literally. This is literal. God is speaking, and he is serious, and he's holy, and he's righteous, and he means what he is saying, whether people undermine it or believe it or live according to it or not. That does not change the truth and the power of it. Am I making sense to you so far? Turn to 1 Corinthians. Praise the living Jesus. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Don't be one of those people who come to church week after week, and when you leave, you forget everything that you were taught. You don't put it into practice. You don't study. You don't care about the things of God. You're not convicted. Because I'm here to tell you, as a person who started off not knowing any of this stuff, now I'm trying to spend my life to warn you, to tell you, if you don't study, if you don't pray, if you allow yourself to continue to be programmed by the world system, by the Antichrist system, you're not going to be able to hear or see or understand or perceive the things that the Holy Spirit has for you to understand and see. Am I making sense to you? Chapter 2 of 1 Corinthians. And these are not new scriptures, but they should hopefully take on a different meaning or a different understanding to you. Chapter 2 of 1 Corinthians. And I'm telling y'all the stuff that I'm researching now. I was showing you all so many things about the Antichrist system. All the things that I've been teaching you all about the Jesuits. All the things that's on the unholy trinity side of this chart that I've been teaching you. I had got to the place where I had to stop, because for me it was too dark. it was some of it was too amazing and sci-fi to be real. But God is bringing me back to it and connecting with other people who's done the same kind of research as we've done. And the stuff that you see the people are doing now right before your eyes is blatant. And when your eyes and your understanding really are open, you really do see stuff that the people around you don't see. And there's no way that you telling them about what you are seeing that you can convince them and get them to receive and accept and change, because that's the work of God. The reason why you are at the place where you are is because you open your heart to Jesus, and only the Holy Spirit can help you to understand and perceive. Am I making sense to you so far? Verse 9 of chapter 2 says, "But that is as it is written, eye has not seen, nor ear heard, neither have it entered into the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for them that love him." Like I've told you on many occasions, you can't love somebody you don't know. You don't know someone you don't spend time with. So it's a cycle. You have to learn them. You have to spend time with them. You have to know them. And the people who don't know, then the opposite would be true. You will never get to know the things that God has prepared, because he's only preparing them for the people who loves him. Do you see it? Okay. "But God has revealed them unto us by his Holy Spirit," capital S. "For the Holy Spirit searches all things, yea, the deep things of God." The Holy Spirit knows the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man save the spirit of man which is in him?" And you know yourself to some level. "Even so, the things of God knows no man but the spirit of God." So you have a human spirit, and your spirit knows you. And just like your spirit knows you, the Holy Spirit of God knows God. "Now we have received not the spirit of the world," talking about believers, "but the Spirit which is of God, that we might know the things that are freely given us of God." We only can know that by the Holy Spirit revealing it to us. "Which things also we speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Ghost teach, comparing spiritual things with spiritual. But the natural man," the people who you run into every day, who live next door to you, who you work with, who you go to school with, they are natural. They do not receive the things of the Spirit of God. Do y'all see this? I know we've been here before, but I pray that the Holy Spirit will highlight this even greater for you today. The natural man cannot understand the things of God, for they are foolishness unto him. They are foolish to the person who is not saved. "Neither can he know them, because they are spiritually discerned." Do you see it? "But he that is spiritual judges all things, yet he himself is judged of no man." Please get this. Your eyes and your ears can only understand the things, hear and see the things of God by the Holy Spirit of God in you. A natural, unsaved person, a regular, everyday person, is not going to see it. And that's what the enemy is doing, is trying to keep people in darkness and keep people in blindness and keep them from being able to see and understand the things that God has for them. So you hear about Jesus, and now the enemy is trying to pass laws to make it so that you can't hear about Jesus, because he thinks he's close to the end of bringing back people, just like the Tower of Babel, bringing people back together again so he can enslave humanity and cause your soul to be eternally damned. So if you live according to this world systems, the god of this world's agenda, the god of this world's plan. If you go after the things of this world, the deceitful things of riches, pursuing the things that you want to perceive, hearing the word of God week after week after week, but you don't change, you don't study, you don't pray, you don't have a relationship with God, then you're deceiving your own selves. Am I making sense to you so far? All right, turn to chapter 3. I want to go over to verse 1 of chapter 3, of same scripture, same chapter book. It says, I, brethren, could not speak unto you as unto spiritual. You see, you can't speak unto people as spiritual, but as unto carnal, even as unto babes in Christ. You carnal people, fleshly people, natural people cannot discern spiritual things. Look at verse 9. Thank you, Jesus. For we are laborers together with God. We are laborers together with God. You are God's husbandry. You are God's building. See, this is what's on the Holy Trinity side of the chart. You are God's building. According to the grace of God, which is given unto me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation, and another builds thereof. But let every man or human being take heed how he builds thereupon. For other foundation can no man lay than that is laid, which is Jesus Christ. Now, if any man build upon this foundation, gold, silver, precious stones, wood, hay, stubble. This is where I want to get to. Every man's work, how you live, shall be made manifest or revealed, for the day shall declare it, because it shall be revealed by fire, and the fire shall try every man's work of what sort it is. If any man's work abide, remains, which he has built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. If any man's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss. But he himself shall be saved. Yet so, he going to be saved yet so as by fire. Do you see it? See, people are playing with fire. Know you not that you are the temple of God? You are the temple of God. I have to keep reminding you of this. You are the temple of God, and that the Spirit, the Holy Spirit of God, dwells in you. If any man defile the temple of God, him shall God destroy. Don't take this lightly. For the temple of God is holy. The temple of God is holy. Which temple you are? You are the temple of God. Don't defile yourself if you really believe Jesus Christ is God. Underline and circle. Let no man deceive himself. Don't deceive yourself. If any man among you seems to be wise in this world, let him become a fool. Don't deceive yourself, people. Don't act one way with Christian people and another way with unchristian people. Don't act one way in public and a different way behind closed doors in private. Don't deceive yourself. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. There's so much about this I wish I had time to really get into. I was really, really blessed by Renata yesterday talking about Tyler going to college. She understands that you need the certificate to show the world that I have gone through the world system to be able to work in the world system. But my life values, how I live my life, is not going to be based on that certificate. It's going to be based on the knowledge and the word of God. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God. For this world is Satan's world's agenda. The systems of this world is based on Satan's values and views. It's perverted, it's corrupt, and it's intended to lead people away from God. Am I making sense to you all so far? I pray that you all get this in a different way. Again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are vain. The thoughts of the wise, they are vain. Going through the world system to get the world certificates and accolades and getting the alphabet behind your name makes you arrogant, prideful, boastful, and vain. According to the scripture that says the thoughts of the wise, they are vain. Therefore, let no man glory in men, for all things are yours. Isn't this something? In verse 4 of chapter 4, it says, I know nothing by myself. Yet I am not hereby justified, but he that judge me is the Lord. Does this make sense to you all? Turn to Hebrews. I hope this is really helping you today. Don't live like you want to live. Live according to God's ways. Don't regulate your life based on the world system, but based on the word of God. Let your hearts be changed. Have eyes that really see what God is doing and see what the enemy is doing. And by the Spirit of God, be able to judge and discern between the two, because you're going to have to every day choose who you're going to allow to use you. Hebrews chapter 10. Hebrews chapter 10. Look at verse 31. It says, it's a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. Isn't that something? But call to remembrance the former days in which after you were illuminated, you endured a great fight of afflictions with an S, plural, partly while you were made a gazing stock, both by reproaches and afflictions, and partly while you became companions of them that were so used, the people who were used. For you had compassion of me and my bonds, and took joyfully the spoiling of your goods, knowing in yourselves that